This is unfailing love. Then you would take my place. Then you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. Then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you done for me, yeah. He holds the whole world. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Amen. Amen. Well, that's why we're here, to celebrate the amazing grace and his unfailing love. We taught you a song last week that just talks about his goodness and that he is a good father, he's a good shepherd, and he is our savior, and that he has plans to prosper us. I invite you to sing this again this morning. He has good things, he has good things for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good things, he has good things for me. If I know my Father, I know my Father has good plans. Yes, you do. He's a good Father. Let's sing this together. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, and he is everything I need. So I will not worry, and I will not fear the enemy. He said that he loves me. He said that he's with me, even though I walk through the valley of
the shadow and death, and still I know He has good plans. He has good plans for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good plans. He has good plans for me. If I know my Father, I know my Father has good plans. Yes.
The Lord is my Savior.
The Lord is my Savior. So why should I doubt my victory? Why should I question the rod and the staff that comforts me? He quiets the waters. He quiets the storm inside of me. So what could be better than walking with Him when I believe? He has good plans. He has good plans for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good plans. He has good plans for me. If I know my Father,
goodness and mercy.
Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. And He has good things. He has good things for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good things. He has good things for me. He has good plans.
He has good plans
for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good plans. He has good plans for me. If I know my Father, I know my Father has good things.
Church, aren't you thankful for that? that God is a God that has good plans for you. Plans for you to prosper, not to harm. Plans that bring you hope and a future. Hey, church.
I guess God's plan was for that mic to break. Man, church, I'm so thankful to worship with you today. It's going to be a great, great Sunday. If you don't know me, my name is Brett, and I'm the Groups and Missions Pastor here at One Church. I'm so excited to worship with you all. Hey, we've got a couple amazing things going on this week specifically, and one of them is Help Build Hope. If you've never been a part of Help Build Hope, it's on April 20th. And what we do is we build two homes for families in need in our very own community. And if you're going, Brett, I'm not a builder, I can't do it. Trust me, you can. It's awesome. It's like putting Legos together, but with hammers and nails. We've got kids out there. We've got families out there. I've had parents tell me before, Brett, I cannot wait until April comes around because I know I get to spend some quality time with my kids outside with our church community. On that day, over 200 volunteers come together. So if you have not signed up, there's space for you. We would love to have you. And one of my favorite parts is just sitting, looking at everybody build, but watching the families that are gonna receive these homes, watching them with just joy, sometimes tears, be so thankful for what they are receiving. Because what you don't know is they put in a lot of work to get these homes as well. It's just a special, special day to bless our community, and you get food at the end, so it's a great time. Church, another thing that happens to come with food is Discover One. Next Sunday, April 21st, we have Discover One. Now, if you don't know what that is, if you're looking for a church, and you've come here and you say, hey, I like what you got going on, or you're kicking the tires on church again, it's just a time to learn a little bit about One Church, hear from Pastor Blake, meet our staff, know what we believe and how you can get involved here. We'd love to have you join us for that. Something fun we've got going on in June that you're going to want to sign up for, there's limited spots, is we're going on a church golf trip. You can call it a retreat if you want. Pastor Blake's going to bring an awesome message, but we're going to play some golf, have a good time, and just connect around maybe some fires, some pools, and also hopefully some good golf shots. It's going to be a great time. Please sign up for that on the events page. And lastly, something I'm really excited about sharing with you, that many of you know every year we have WinShape on our campus. And over 500 kids come here to learn about Jesus, to have fun, and really some of their lives are changed forever and eternity. But there's some kids in our community that may not be in a situation where they can pay for WinShape. And what our church has decided to do is we've decided to take 45 kids of the 500 and some odd kids that come here and cover their cost. I've got a couple stories. I've had the opportunity to read through some of these families and some of what these kids are going through each day. And one kid's name is Caden, and he lives with his grandmother right now. He doesn't have any other family members. His grandmother, due to health situations, can't drive. And so the only time Caden goes out is when he gets on the bus to go to school Monday through Friday, when he gets on the bus to come home. And this summer, they said, hey, we'll figure out a way to get him to WinShape, but we can't cover the cost. And so our church has said, hey, we'll raise our hand. We're going to cover the cost of Caden's trip. And you guys have the opportunity to partner with so many kids just like Caden. There's another kid named Curtis, whose father passed away. He doesn't know his mom. And Curtis right now is living with his older sister. She's got her own family, and they don't have the finances to bring every kid to WinShape. And so Curtis is another child that we've said, hey, we'll sponsor Curtis. And if you want to be a part of that, part of adopting a kid for the week of WinShape, you can go out into the lobby and find Lori, and she's got more information for you on that. And, you know, in the spirit of adoption, something we do every single week here is we take communion together. And on this Sunday, thinking about, hey, we're going to adopt some kids for WinShape, I want to remind you that you've been adopted into a family because of Christ Jesus, because of him laying down his life for you, pouring out his blood for you. And as a reminder of this, we take communion each and every Sunday together. So church, today, when I pray, I just want you to take communion today in a spirit of thankfulness. Be thankful that you have been adopted into the family of God through the work of Christ Jesus. So can we pray together? Lord, we thank you for today. God, we thank you that you're good. We thank you that you're holy. We thank you that you're mighty. God, we thank you that we have been adopted into the family of God. Jesus, thank you that you poured out your blood to cover our sins. Thank you, Lord, for allowing your body to be beaten and bruised for us. Lord, we love you and we praise you in your name. Amen.
How we doing, One Church? You guys all right? Come on. My family's here. So my name is Blake, and I'm the lead pastor. I just want to welcome everybody in the house. I also want to do something really fast. Every week, our online attendance is just like growing and growing. And so let's say hello to all of them. Hello. It's great to have you. No matter where you are, it's fantastic. So we are in a series right now called Taking Ground, and it's about spiritual warfare. And I am super blessed today because I have one of my dear friends here to bring a message that I think is very timely, and it's fire. It's Holy Spirit fire, so I hope you're ready. So his name is Donnie Karpinen, and he's a lead pastor down in Florida in a place called Boca Raton. You guys ever been to Boca Raton? Yeah, in Spanish, that means mouth of the rat. I don't know if you knew that. So I don't know why you want to live in a place that's called mouth of the rat, but he does. So it's a beautiful place. He actually has taken over his father's church, and his father is my pastor. He's a spiritual father in my life. And Donnie, his son, is sort of like a spiritual son to me. I've watched Donnie go through some very hard times, and he has grown as a leader and as a pastor, and the church under his care in a short amount of time has tripled in size. So it's amazing. Victory.org, if you want to go to his church and check out what's happening there. He's on fire. It's amazing what's happening through his leadership. But I have walked through some really hard seasons of life with Donnie and his wife, Brittany. They're amazing. They're very close to me and my family. And so it's a super big honor for me to have him come today. And here's why. He just wrote a book, and this book is called Good Things Come to Those Who Take. And so this is the inspiration for this entire series, Taking Ground. And I feel like I kind of co-wrote it with him because there were so many seasons that I walked through with him as he was forging this book in the fire of his soul. And so I love this book so much that I was like, I want to be the first place that you go to speak. I want to buy one copy for every family in my church. And so you guys can go out into the lobby after this and get one per family after this service. That's good news, isn't it? And yeah, and so I want you guys to have one of these and you can meet Donnie and talk to him. But I do ask to take one because we only bought a limited supply. And so if you want more, you can go to Amazon.com and they'll be available this Tuesday. They're not even available yet. And so you're the first ones to get to hear this message, to hear my friend Donnie come and speak. And so he has battled anxiety, depression, and fear like nobody I've ever seen. And he's now on the other side of it. And he wrote the book to talk about it. So if you struggle with any of those mental health issues and have a battle with an anxiety, you're going to love hearing today's message. So do me a favor, get your hands together and get rowdy for my dear friend, Donnie Carpenter.
All right. It's an honor to be here. If you're glad to be in church, let me hear you say, yeah. You know, last service, Pastor Blake introduced me, something along the lines of, he's like, and he's the most anxious person that I know. And I'm like, that introduction made me anxious. No, but it has been a journey for me. I'm going to talk to you about that. But first, what I have to do, I cannot not do this, is I've got to honor your pastor, everybody. Do you have any idea that Pastor Blake Bergstrom is one of the best human beings on the planet? And can we make some noise for the pastor here at One Church? It's not any kind of hyperbole at all for me to say he walked me through the hardest moments of my life. It's not hyperbole. I mean, we're talking about like it was do or die, it was make or break. And in some of the moments that were completely debilitating for me of anxiousness and depression, feeling a lot of shame, all kinds of stuff, I just want to tell you, he loved me back to life. There was actually a conversation that we had on a mountain in Tennessee, and that conversation was so instrumental in my life, in my future, in my destiny, in my family. I got a tattoo of a mountain on my arm because I'll never forget what God did on that mountain. Very few people that you can say, oh, I opened up my heart to you at a very difficult and trying time, and you showed me what Christ looks like and what it means to be a real Christian when I didn't really know where I was going to go. And so, guys, that's your pastor. Pastor Blake and Allie are the absolute real deal through and through. And it's no wonder that God is breathing his breath and his spirit on this church because of their love, their authenticity, their purity. They love you. And I can't say enough. I could keep going, but I got the timer's already on. So I got to keep it going. Hey, my wife and my daughters are here. My daughters are in the kids ministry. There's my wife, Brittany, right there, who's also right there. And Jensen and Rowan. Jensen's the slightly taller 9-year-old. Rowan is almost 7. She'll be 7 next year. This is crazy because my wife and I, this summer, will celebrate 14 years of marriage and 10 days. Yeah, that's awesome. 10 days from today, April 24th, we'll be celebrating our 19-year anniversary of the day that I told you I like you. We still count that, everybody. And so I love you. Thank you for supporting me. Thank you for being here. Thank you for helping make this book a reality and just to bless people. You know, this series is about taking ground, taking back territory that the enemy has stolen. And there's an emphasis on that word taking for a reason. I'm actually here to tell you, of course, giving is a strong spiritual principle and found in Scripture, but I actually want to submit to you that so is taking authority in Jesus' name for everything that God has made available to us. It's about taking hold of the fullness of life that Jesus talks about in John 10:10. He says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Now, I don't know about you, but I grew up in church. I heard John 3:16, one of the most famous, if not the most famous verses. Tim Tebow had it on the eye black in that championship game, right? When he played for UF. And actually 90 million people Googled John 3:16 when he did that. And it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have eternal life. And growing up in church, I would hear that verse and I would oftentimes think, oh, well, yeah, alternative. I would only have one way of thinking about eternal life. And that was, oh, that's for the afterlife. That's one day when I die. I'm not thinking about it now. Especially being young, I'm out of touch with my own mortality. I don't even have to think about that now. I don't have to consider that now. I don't have to ponder on that now. That's just something that's going to be a reality one day if I have faith in Jesus. But as I got closer to God and I understood his word more and more and more, and I understood what Jesus actually came to do, I started to realize that eternal life is not an afterlife thing. It actually starts now. It's a today thing and a then thing. Watch this. Paul wrote to a young pastor, Timothy, he was mentoring in 1 Timothy 6:12, and he says, fight. Everybody say fight. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you've been called. I read that and I went, hold on. Paul's not writing to a dead person. He's writing to a living person. If this was just an afterlife thing, why would he tell him to take hold of anything that he can't take hold of until he dies? But he says, fight the good fight of faith. Can I tell you, by the way, that the eternal life that which you've been called, that there is an enemy who comes to steal, kill, and destroy, who does not want you to take hold of what Jesus offers to you. And so he knows you're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. That's what he said to Timothy. He said it in Philippians 3. He said, not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Make no mistake, Jesus paid the price. Jesus purchased us back on the cross, face down the devil, has made eternal life available to us, but there is a taking that we have to do, not just this passivity. Otherwise, Paul wouldn't have never have said, fight the good fight of faith. How about this? One more. Jesus famously said in Matthew chapter 11, he said, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. If you're anything like me, remember reading that verse before and being like, I don't really know what that means. I'm just going to keep on reading and keep moving. That's interesting. But he's not talking about an assault on heaven in some kind of a negative sense. He's not talking about a war against heaven in the way that we hear about wars today. He's actually saying that Jesus knew that there was such a desperation in people that when he came and brought the kingdom of heaven, he said the kingdom of heaven is at hand, right? When he came and he healed people and he cast demons out of people and he set people free and he invited them into this eternal life, that people were so desperate to receive it and to take hold of it, mobs thronged Jesus, followed him everywhere. He couldn't get away. People fought through crowds just to touch the hem of his garment so that they could be healed. That at one point, Jesus was in a house and he was ministering to so many different people that there was a paralyzed man that his friends wanted to get into him, that perhaps Jesus could heal him, but they couldn't get him to him. So what did they do? They tore a hole in the roof of the place and lowered him down. It's that kind of a desperation. It's that kind of a taking that Jesus said the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. And the violent take it by force. And so listen, friends, sometimes there's a, yes, taking hold of the eternal life. And there is taking back from the enemy the territory that he has taken from us. Can I get an amen? And so that's what we're talking about today. And we're talking about how the kingdom of heaven is at hand, is what Jesus said. That's why I wrote a book called Good Things Come to Those Who Take, taking hold of all that God has for your life. And make no mistake, listen, don't hear what I'm not saying. We are awaiting heaven. It's the new heavens and the new earth that we're waiting for, the culmination of all things, the renewal of all things, where all things will be made perfect. No more sickness, disease, pain, betrayal, pandemics, wars. Can I get an amen? But also, in some mysterious way, Jesus also brought heaven down so that these two worlds begin to cross over each other now. And we, the people of God, are called to actually usher in the kingdom of God to earth now. That's right. Come on. Now, not someday. If it was just about give my life to Jesus so that I can be taken away to heaven someday, then why wouldn't he have just taken us right away? Why are we here now wasting time? Because we're not wasting time, because we're a part of bringing God's kingdom to earth now. And that requires a taking hold of it and a taking back from the enemy. Somebody say amen. I'm feeling it in this service. So I just want you to know it is very welcome for you to just make some noise, holler back. The better you respond, the better I will preach. Last week, Pastor Blake talked about spiritual warfare. And he talked about challenging the devil. And we got to learn how to do that because, newsflash, the devil's always challenging us. So we're either responding or we're just getting our teeth kicked in. It's kind of like that's our two options, I feel like, essentially. And that's crucially important. Challenging the devil, knowing the battle that you're in, and bringing God's kingdom to earth. And yes, we need to take authority over Satan with the power of Jesus, but we also need, and here's what I want to get into today, to take responsibility for our own hearts, our minds, and ultimately our life. Listen, it's one thing to say, come on, we gotta go take back culture. And that matters. And we gotta know what the enemy's up to in media and music and all of the things, absolutely. But can I submit to you that it actually starts with taking back territory that he has taken in our hearts and in our minds? I told you that I've struggled with anxiety, and I've struggled with anxiety my whole life. I didn't know it was called that. I didn't know to call it that until about 7 or 8 years ago. And I started working through some things with a therapist. And I looked back on my life and went, oh, yeah, I've been an anxious mess my whole life. From the time I was young. I began to follow my memories back to elementary school. Started with when I was first began to be dropped off, even at a Christian school, great school, safe place, good teachers, good people, all that kind of stuff, that I would be overwhelmed with fear and anxiety, fear of abandonment, that I wouldn't get picked back up by my parents. I vividly remember first grade, second grade, third grade, my dad dropping me off, have fun for a minute, and then start to just ruminate on, oh my gosh, what if he doesn't come back? When we would near the last hour of the day, everything the teacher would start to say would just start to get foggy and I couldn't really hear it because I would just start to be so concerned that, oh, we're getting near the end of the day. Is today the day that I don't get picked up? And my dad, again, we didn't know to call it this, anxiety, but my dad just knew that I was struggling. And my dad, who's the best man that I know, by the way, everybody, we get to still serve in ministry together to this day, loving people in Boca Raton and beyond. It's a beautiful thing. It's amazing. But my dad knew that I was struggling with this, and he started to show up to school 45 minutes to an hour early. And he would park at the very, very, very far parking lot, because they wouldn't let him park closer because of traffic flow for the pickup lines and all that kind of stuff. And he'd walk a long way, and he'd get to the desk, and he would check in. And then he would just stand outside of the classroom door where there's just that little glass window, you know, and just stick his head right there so that I could see it and see that he's out there and I could just take a breath and be okay. And as I started to think about stuff, I'm like, okay, yeah, I've been kind of anxious for quite some time. What in the world is going on? What is the big traumatic event, right? Because a lot of times that's what we think. And a lot of times it is. There's something there we have to uncover. We have to allow the Holy Spirit to heal. But I was like, what is it in my life that I experienced? Let me try to go. When was I abandoned? What was the big traumatic event? I couldn't come up with anything. I couldn't figure out what it was until I actually started to realize that it was biological and generational. And I'd be like, what are you talking about? Well, I could go a bunch of different routes with this to kind of try to prove this point, but I'm just going to give you one and keep it moving. I read in a book called The End of Mental Illness by Dr. Daniel Amen, there was a study done on mice. When they did this study on mice, what they did is they would constantly give them a certain scent of a flower. I think it was lavender, if I'm not mistaken. A lavender scent of a flower, which is really sad because that's supposed to like calm you down. Right? You're like, ah. But then they would shock them, okay? So they would present this scent of a flower to them, and then it would shock them. And then they would present the scent, and they would shock them, and they would present the scent, and they would shock them. And then they would begin to present the scent and not shock them, but still measure their vital signs. And their blood pressure would go up. And their heart rate would go way up and they would go into a state of panic and anxiety, anticipating the shock even when they weren't being shocked. You would expect that, right? Because they've been conditioned. But what's more surprising is that the next generation of mice that never experienced the traumatic event of being shocked, whenever they smelled the smell, they had the exact same reaction. Hey, the next generation of mice that never experienced that traumatic event of being shocked had the exact same reaction to being presented that scent of a flower. And so there are generational attacks, and at a biological level, at a physiological level, into our DNA sometimes. And when I started to think about this, I was like, oh yeah, when I think about my mom's family line and my dad's family line and some of the stuff that they've been through, there's a laundry list. I don't even have the time to think about some of the traumatic things that they went through. And so I tell you all of this to say, because if you're like, I don't know, what is the thing? Was there a thing in my life? Is it somebody else? Listen, regardless, if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. And if you're not taking notes, I want you to write this down. Here's the point. Whole people are victims who choose to be responsible instead. It's not fair what might have happened to you, what might have been done to you, what you experienced, or what your family line experienced. But can I tell you something today? The Bible says that you are more than a conqueror, that you are an overcomer. And last I checked, you can't be a victim and more than a conqueror at the same time. One of those has to be true. Which one are you going to believe today? Whole people are victims who choose to be responsible instead. It might not have been my fault, but I'm going to make it my responsibility to take hold of all that God has for my life. And I'm going to tell the enemy he has to take his hands off because he has no legal right, says the blood of Jesus. Amen. So here's what I want us to get. First and foremost, I want to honor the foundation that was laid last week, because Pastor Blake and I talked a lot about this. And we've got to understand that spiritual warfare is real, and that attacks from the devil are real, and demons are real, and all this stuff. We got our own stories, okay, with some of this stuff that we've faced. But let me just tell you something, because I want to balance this out for a second, lest you only go to one side very far. The devil doesn't need to attack you if you're doing a good enough job beating up yourself. I think sometimes we give him too much credit. Everything's a spiritual attack. Everything. I didn't get a close parking spot at the mall. The enemy is at it today. I'm just, oh my gosh, like, come on. Like all the things, we can do that. But I just want to submit to you that sometimes it's not a demonic attack that you have to rebuke. It might be a brain and body thing that's going on within the inside of you that you need to learn how to take responsibility for. That's what I want to talk about today. That's where we're going to go with this today. You see, the devil doesn't need to attack you if you're doing a good enough job beating up yourself. Sometimes the way he attacks, watch this, is he just sets things in motion. And then he backs off. And let stuff spin. I was thinking about this. The student pastor at my church, Pastor Eli, he and Aliana adopted two beautiful little boys, man, Daniel and Darnell. And every Sunday night, they go on Instagram Live and they play games. And people like, you know, like vote for like who they think are going to win and who's going to win. It's the cutest thing ever, man. But they play this game called Beyblades. And so they have these like top spinner things. And there's like a little arena where the top spinners like fight each other. And you're like, what's going to be the last one standing? And I was thinking about this. I'm like, this is exactly the way the enemy does it sometimes. Is there's a one time, watch. To get those spinners spinning for as long as they do, you hit a ripcord one good time. It applies trauma, if you will, to this thing. It starts spinning. There's no longer this spiritual attack as it continues to spin. It was a one-time thing, and then you're hands off and you just watch it go. Sometimes that's what the enemy does with us. There was an attack. It was real. You need to recognize it, whether it was in your specific life or your family's. But then sometimes we can be, it's always a demon and it's always a spiritual warfare and it's always this thing. And it's actually just like, you're giving him way too much credit. He's now hands off and watching you just allow the thing to keep spinning.
Come on.
When are you gonna just grab the thing and say, that's enough? That's enough. We're not doing the spinning anymore. We're not doing it. I'm not, somebody say, I'm not spinning anymore. Come on. We allow the things to continue to spin sometimes by making agreements with the enemy, even if we don't realize. You're like, what does that mean? What does that mean? It means that making agreements is accepting wrong thinking and wrong mindsets that are not in accordance with the word of God and the will of God for our lives. Can I tell you that mental health challenges are on the rise like the world has never seen? If you are struggling, you are in good company. Let me tell you. The enemy seeks to steal, kill, and destroy, and he's having his way in so many ways. I want you to see this. I've got some mental health statistics. First of all, 45% of adults ages 35 to 44 reported a mental illness in 2023, compared with 31% in 2019, probably because after we walked through this pandemic. 50% of adults ages 18 to 34 reported a mental illness in 2023. 15% of adults had a substance use disorder in the past year. 93.5% did not receive treatment. More than 2.7 million youth are experiencing severe major depression. And 60% of youth with major depression do not receive mental health treatment, according to the American Psychological Association and Mental Health America. Here's what I want to tell you today on week two of this Taking Ground series, and we're talking about taking responsibility. Here's what I want you to know, that a lot of times taking back territory that the enemy has stolen, it starts in your mind. In your mind. We can be so quick to be out there. Let's go get it. Let's go this. Let's go speak truth to power. Yes, all of it. But don't neglect where the enemy has been wreaking havoc right here. In your mind. So if you're taking notes, write this down. I got 3 points for you. In order to take back territory the enemy has stolen and take hold of all that God has for you, you have to, these three things, ready? Take rule over your thought life, take control over your confession, and take care of your whole self. Let me talk to you about that. Let's talk about taking rule over your thought life. Everybody say, take rule. Take rule over your thought life. You know, our brains are so interesting. Did you know that one human brain generates more energy in a day than all of the cell phones in the entire world combined? Wow. That's some neuroscientist kind of stuff. That's crazy. And so watch this. If you have that between your eyes and ears right here, then guess what? That kind of power and energy, it's either working for you or it's working against you. Those are really like your two options. It's kind of crazy. Perhaps that's why Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he." So as he thinks in his heart? What does that even mean? I was almost like, that don't make any sense. How do you think in your heart? Well, watch this. What is the gateway to the heart? The mind. Nothing is getting into your heart without first coming in through your mind, your thought life. That's why you've got to take rule over your thought life. That's why Jesus, the scripture says to guard your heart, Proverbs 4, for everything you do flows from it. As you think in your heart, so will you be. So the direction you will go. So will your family go. So will your destiny go. That's why Jesus said, come on, you gotta guard your heart. Everything you do flows from it. Can I tell you something from a testimony standpoint? And all the glory to God, when I started to intentionally change my mindset, and by the way, I personally needed some professional help with this. I needed all the help. Yeah, you know, that was Pastor Blake. He's like, at a certain point, you're like, bro, you're gonna have to talk to somebody else. Like, you know, just. But I was stuck. There's a part of my brain that was literally stuck, just ruminating, can't get past this, can't get past this, can't get past this, can't get past this negative thought, can't get past this thing. But when I started to intentionally change my mindset, listen, let me tell you, when I was in the lowest place of my life, I began to listen to fear, and I would be afraid that, oh my goodness, what if this never gets any better? Or even worse, what if I somehow get worse? And guess what? In this point of taking rule over your thought life, every time I thought that way, guess what happened? I got worse. I started to spiral. It wasn't until I began to think differently how I thought about my life, I began to experience far more hope and joy. I started to feel different, more energy, more passion, more faith, hope, and love. Are you kidding me? That I would get to, by God's grace, write a book to help give people hope and tell them about the good news of Jesus, that you don't have to spiral, but that it does get better. I'm speaking to somebody who needs to hear this today in church, that though the sorrow may last for the night, joy comes in the morning. You're gonna be okay. You're gonna be okay. There are some promises that we have to hold on to, and we've got to take rule over our thought life. Guarding your heart. By guarding your heart, you can change your mind. And by changing your mind, you can change your life. Perhaps that's why 2 Corinthians 10, 4 through 5 says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." Listen now, don't miss it. Casting down arguments, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, talking about strongholds. By how? Wait, by bringing every thought. Strongholds start with thoughts. Every high thing, spiritually speaking, demonic thing that would exalt itself against Christ is torn down through our thoughts. Taking every thought into captivity. Man, sometimes you get some stupid thoughts that you do not have to believe. You just don't have to. There's not truth behind it. Just the sabotaging enemy. Just stuck mental patterns that don't want you to break through. A lot of times it's not some unclean spirit. He doesn't need to deploy those entities at you if you're doing a good enough job sabotaging yourself with what goes on between your two ears, your thought life. So like I like to get really practical. And so here's one simple thing amongst many other things that I've done, but one simple thing that changed a lot of things for me is, at night, I don't know if you're anything like me, but sometimes once the day kind of calms down just a little bit and it gets a little bit more quiet and I lay my head on my pillow, then it's where the brain is just like, I'm catastrophizing. What if this goes wrong? What if they're thinking that? What if this person's going to leave? What if all that stuff can happen, right? But watch, instead, you have control over your brain that God has given you. For God has not given us a spirit of fear. It doesn't come from him. What comes from him is power, love, and a sound mind. So we have to take hold of it and take rule over our thought life. And so we're really simple. Now when I go to bed, I'm like, yeah, we're not going to run that play. We're not going to turn on that channel. That is, it's my choice. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to think about three wins for the day. Three things that went well today. Some days, man, I feel like I just absolutely killed it. It was the best day ever. That's a quick three. They come real fast. I don't have to think that hard. Other days, I have to kind of mine the gold out of the day and try to think. But let me tell you right now what I've been teaching my six-year-old, who has sometimes started to catastrophize even at night already. I'm like, no, 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 no. I know there are three good things that you can think on today and thank God for. Because every day is a gift from him. Three things. You think about those things. You just feel those things. I begin to feel differently, sleep differently, wake up ready to attack the day differently. Perhaps that's why Paul said in Philippians 4, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Come on. What'd you say? Looking through the window, man. I think that what that scripture is not saying, it's not saying that if you don't think on these things, that then God leaves you. No, the scripture, the promise is that he'll never leave you and that he'll never forsake you. But I think the awareness of his presence and the felt manifest presence of God is not something that we get to experience when we're circling, spiraling, catastrophizing. But when we think on whatever is right, true, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, or praiseworthy, his felt presence is right there with us. The God of peace is with us. So listen, so you got to take rule over your thought life, but you also need to take control over your confession. That means what you say, what you confess, what you say out loud about your life and about your situation. For Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. It's kind of another way of saying, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he, but also in what you speak. Because whatever gets in your heart comes in through your mind and comes out your mouth. So what we say matters. I'm talking about taking responsibility about what we say over our situation, what we say about the evidence even in front of us. Can I tell you something? Can I tell you that there were 12 spies wanted to go into the promised land, right? And 10 of the 12, they gave a report. Oh, it's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. There's giants in the land. We know that God promised us this land. It's quite literally called the promised land. They're like, but I think he messed up. Because there's giants. We got no chance. They're going to eat us. They're going to destroy us. They're going to kill us. You know, there were two, Joshua and Caleb, who had a different confession. You know what they actually said about the giants in the land? They said, they will become bread for us. Amen. That's a different confession. That's 12 people saw the exact same thing. Two had a different report. Which one, what kind of report are you going to have? Taking rule over your thought life, taking control over your confession. Can I tell you, it sounds like I'm bragging, because for a second I am. I did everything in my life early. When I was 15 years old, I wrote down how I'm going to propose to that girl right there. And then I did it when I was 19 and married at 20. And she's a year older than me. She's 21. She was 21. I was 20. On our honeymoon, we went on a cruise. She had to sign on as my legal guardian. Because I wasn't 21. That's a real story, which is hilarious and also very sad and embarrassing. But I did everything early. I graduated college way ahead of all of my friends. I bought a house early. I did all these things early. I had my first nervous breakdown early. I did, because I wasn't aware of some unhealthy things in my heart, in my mind, in my thought patterns. I was going. Had a lot to prove. And can I tell you, when I hit this low, I remember being so anxious. My arms, I couldn't feel them. I was so depressed. Everything in me just wanted to go to bed and stay in bed. But I would walk around my neighborhood, and I'll quote Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." If you don't know what anxiety feels like, it kind of feels like a 30-pound weight on your chest. And you're just really struggling to get one deep breath. If you're not sure what depression feels like, it kind of feels like you're in the ocean and that 30-pound weight is on your chest that has now pushed you down beneath the waves, and you don't think you're ever going to come up for your next breath. And that's where I was. I'm crying, quoting Psalm 23 and Psalm 100 and every scripture that I could summon up out of my spirit. It freaked me out, man. I was like, okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to, like, not do this. So we're going to do everything. So I started to research. I started to eat differently, drink a ton of water, start to exercise, pray the prayers, do the spiritual warfare, quote the scriptures, read the word of God. I was like, all the essential oil people, where you at? Young Living? I'll take it. What do you got? Just everything. All the stuff. Right? But I remember my confession mattered. I remember being on a treadmill. Pastor Blake, I remember you telling me, get your heart rate up over 150, start to sweat. I did. I'd be on that treadmill. My wife sent me a song by Jen Johnson that said, you're going to be okay. The song is called, You're Going to Be Okay. And it took everything in me from the deepest place to just mumble the words, I'm going to be okay. I would praise and I would worship. I would declare the promises of God. I vividly remember putting on a song, Coming Home, by a band called Ren Collective, called Counting Every Blessing. Have you heard it? I'm counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. Counting every blessing, counting every blessing. Surely every season, you are good to me. And I remember saying to my family, I had a newborn, saying to my wife, we're going to sing and we're going to dance, even though I don't want to sing and I don't want to dance, but we're going to do it. And I took control over my confession, and slowly but surely the darkness began to lift and the light came back on at home. Come on. So take rule over your thought life and take control over your confession. And come on, somebody, last but not least, I can't say enough about this, but I don't have that much time, so get the book. It's free. Take care of your whole self. Your whole self. What does that mean? I'm talking about not just spiritually. I'm talking about not just slapping a Bible verse on your suffering. I'm talking about mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual. We are holistic beings created in the image of God. And what we cannot do is just say, it's all physical. It's all just spiritual. It's all mental. No. Holistically and together, we've got to begin to take care of our whole self. When I talk about mental, I'm talking about our thought life. I'm talking about brain health. I've studied so much on this, wrote a little bit about it. I'm talking about being intentional with our three wins. I'm talking about, because friend, if you're struggling right now, I want you to hear some really good news. Even though that brain that's that powerful has maybe been working against you, you're not in a fixed state. Scripture says, do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And science tells us some good news that's in accordance with the scripture. It's the principle of neuroplasticity. That means that your brain is malleable and adaptable, and it is always changing. So you might be struggling and you might be suffering right now because there are some neural pathways that have been deep grooved into your brain. But can I tell you something? That the word of God and the truth of his word can create some new neural pathways in your brain. Your brain might say, we're used to going this way, which is really scary in a roller coaster and down into the depths of the basement and the catastrophizing. But maybe there's a new neural pathway that says there's a new one and it's the river of life. Let's go this way. And you can create that in your brain. I'm talking about mental. I'm talking about emotional. You might need a therapist. There is no shame. Destigmatize that. I needed some professional help. I needed some tools. I'm talking about emotionally having a real relationship with God, a dynamic relationship with God, where you can be honest with him, not think that you have to have everything pieced together and primed and proper and I have to say all the right things. God can handle the sordidness that's going on within your heart. I'm talking about having real and meaningful relationships with other believers who can point you back to Jesus, not help reinforce your negative toxic patterns. Amen? I'm talking about physical, taking care of your body, considering what we eat and what we drink. Inflammation messes with our brain. Blood flow, decreased blood flow based on what we eat. This messes with our brain. Sleep matters. The straw that broke the camel's back for me when I had a nervous breakdown in 2017 was 3 months of no sleep due to a brand new newborn. Just, it amongst all the other things, it broke me, man. And then last but not least, it's the foundation, everybody. Spiritual. Because the enemy does want to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, but I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. So I'm talking about prayer. I'm talking about worship. I'm talking about warfare and talking back to the enemy. Because he's always talking at you. Sometimes it's time that you start talking back and you say, nope, Jesus said that it is finished. Nope, Jesus said that death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory, and where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You got to get some scripture in your heart and in your soul, and you got to push him back when he's trying to push you. In 1 Corinthians 6, I'm closing. It says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? And you're not your own, for you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. That's mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual. If you didn't hear anything at all today and you just dragged yourself in here and you don't even feel like you got hope for tomorrow, can I just tell you something right now? Though the sorrow may last for the night, joy does come in the morning. Abundant life, the fullness of life, that eternal life, it's yours right now for the taking. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Jesus already paid the price for your eternal life. You just have to take hold of it. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's pray together. Every head bowed and every eye closed. God, I thank you. I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your promises. I thank you for the eternal life that you've made available to us. Help us, Holy Spirit, to now just take hold of all that you have for us. And as we're praying, if there's anybody here today that would say, I don't know that I know that I know that I have a relationship with God, I get to offer you the best news in the whole world. It's what we said in the beginning, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. I'm here to tell you some good news, that God is kinder than you think he is, and he's more patient with you than you are with yourself. His arms are always open wide, and he's inviting you in right now. If you would say, Pastor Donnie, I don't know that I have a relationship with God, and you want one, or perhaps you say, today is the day that I need to rededicate my life to be all in on following Jesus and taking hold of this eternal life that he has made available to me. If that's you here today, without hesitation, would you put your hand up with every head bowed and every eye closed? Let me know if that's you here today, that I just get to pray over you. I'm not going to invite you forward or embarrass you or anything like that. I just want to know if that's you here today. Let me see across this place. Say, I want to rededicate my life to Jesus, or I want to receive him for the very first time. Amen. 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 And here's how I want to close. I want us all to pray this prayer together. I would love for you to just repeat it after me. Every voice here, come on. Say, dear God, I believe that you love me and that you sent your son Jesus to die for me. And his sacrifice was enough. God, I give you my sin and I take hold of your righteousness. God, from this day forward, you're my father. And I'm your child. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Come on, let's give God praise, everybody. Love you all. Thank you so much.
Church, what a powerful message from Pastor Donnie.
And hey, I want you to know that today, this morning, I can already tell that the Holy Spirit's pulling on some of your hearts. And we've got a team that's all around the room on the walls up front that wants to pray with you, that wants to pray the promises of the Lord over your life. If you made a decision to follow Christ today, we want to pray with you. As we worship today, I just want to encourage you to come around the room to pray with our prayer leaders. And also, as you leave today, please grab this as a gift. It's going to make a massive difference in your life. It's free for you. Our church, we love you. So church, let's worship together today.
So Jesus, we just rest in that truth that there's power, that there's forgiveness, that there's hope, there's grace and mercy in your name alone. So Jesus, we rest in you. Everything that we need is found in who you are. Thank you for being more than enough. Thank you for being healing. Jesus, we love you, and we claim all of this because of who you are, because of all that you've done. We pray in your name. Amen. Amen. Can we give him praise this morning? Holy Spirit's doing some amazing things in this house, and we're so grateful to worship with you this morning. If you would still like to pray with someone, if you'd like to talk with someone, if there's anything that you need to talk about, we'll still have a team down front as you dismiss today. Hope you guys have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.